Okay, so shall we start the? So let's start with the mutable one. Okay, let's create a. Okay, let's create a class. Our favorite class, student. Okay. Third row, blue t-shirt. Okay. No more PUBG. Okay. Int ID. Okay. So string ID and name. Now let's have a. Let's see something interesting about the Eclipse. What you can do, right click, source, select all. Okay, so what it has done, it has created all the member functions. You don't have to worry about it, it's recorded in the video, you can play back. Okay, so now we have created a user defined class. So anyway, what we need to do, just right click on the editor, source, generate getter setter. Okay, there are a lot of things to learn. Right now our concept is not learning the user defined class. Our focus is what on understanding the concept of mutability. Okay. Now let's create a program called main2. Okay. Here. Okay, now how to explain the concept of mutability? So we'll do a comparison between what? String and student. Okay, we'll update the string object and we'll update the student object. To show you that in case of string, a new object has been created when you update, and in case of student, in case of our user defined class, the same objects are getting updated. String str is equal to, let's suppose, hello world. Okay, and let's create a two object. So how many objects we created? One simple string object. Can I print the value here? How to print the value? Right now I am printing what? The hash code. Okay. How to print the hash code? str.hashCode. And let's also print what? Let's put a something before that. Identifier. Sorry. In the same way, what we can do? Every object has hash code. Okay, shall we run the program? Run as Java application. The another advantage you got what? We do not have to what? Compile and all. Okay, so you ran that and you knew that. This is the hello world, this is the string, and this is the hash code for that, and this is what? An object of student type, and it has some hash code. Okay, now let's do what? Now let's update it. Update each object. Each object means what? First the immutable object and then the mutable object. Str is equal to what you have written now? Hello. Okay, that means what we have done? We have modified our str. Okay, and now that means we have modified our string object. So let's print here what the hash code for the str. Yes, that means we can copy this. Okay, now let's try to update in the same way. Let's try to update what? Okay, std.set name is equal to, let's suppose I'm setting the name as right now Kharger, or let's suppose Sidek Kharger. So now can I print? So can I say that we have updated both the object? One is what? String, and another is one what? Which object we are updating? STD. How did you confirm that? STD. STD we are updating. So now can I say that here? Okay. What we can write here? I can again make a reference for this. Is it clear? So after updating the each object, let's see what is the value. Now we can see that hello world. Hello world was the string object. It has a hash code. Now it has been changed to what? Universe. That means the it has been updated. I am again taking a wrong example. Instead of hash code, I could have taken some other thing, which I will show right now also. That one also. That means we can say that something has been changed. And here in this case also, but in this case, in case of student. The object is what?
Same.
So that means I just want to we just wanted a very brief understanding that in case of a string, the object always creates, when you update a string, it always creates a new object, and in case of normal or user defined class, it updates the same object. Okay? Now let's do another thing. Let's learn something interesting here. Something interesting with the help of Eclipse, that is called debugging. Okay, now this time what we will do, we'll do what? Instead of running the application, we'll do what? Run debug as application. Right click. Instead of run as, we'll choose the option debug as. Is it visible? Debug as Java application. So it will prompt some window. Okay, it has run successfully. Why? Because there was no, to debug the application we'll do what? We'll apply some debug point. Let's go to our start of the program, line number 6, and put a debug point. Can you see that your point?
Yes.
How did you bring that point? By just simply clicking over there. If you double click, it will appear. If you just again double click, it will disappear. That it will toggle. Let's put a debug point now. Okay, now let's do what? Right click, and then where shall we go? Debug as Java application. So now something is prompting up. So here you can say either yes or no. So basically I will always prefer no. Okay, so can you observe something? Your program execution has been stopped. You can see there is a green line. Okay, green line means what? Your program execution has been stopped. And how can you verify that? You can see that there is a red red button. That means it indicates that your program is running and it has been stopped. Okay, it is asking your permission to go to the next line. It is asking your permission, you can say. So now, how can you go to the next line? So there are two options. There are arrows. Here you can see the arrow. Can you read this? Okay, there is an arrow, step into, and there is a step over. That means either you use F5 or F6. We will use the command F6. So in this way, where we are going? We are going to the next line. Step over, F6. Now here, what is the advantage of debugging? Now here you can see that, what is the value of the str? You can read it. What is the object ID? Object ID, some identity has been given, 15. You can also, okay? Or the value. There is some unique identities over there. Now, you can go to the again next line like this. So, since you have printed the value, you can see the value here. Or if you, I don't want to disturb him again and again, so what I will do? Where is my console? This is the console window. I will just do what? I will drag this. Okay. I will drag this here. And I will drag this here. So now it will not disturb me. So what I will do? Let's go to the next line. And again we can mouse over to the our student variable. Okay, you can see that student also it has got some ID. And now it has been printed here. Printed the value. The value of the your string, that is the hash code and the hash code of the our student object. Now, we are trying to change what? We are trying to change the value of the string. So, since once you have changed the value of the string, now you can change. Can you see? The ID has been changed. What was the value initially? 15. It was something different. So, that's what? I can say that a new object has been created. Yes? Say yes. That's what? Hash code was a wrong comparison. A new object has been created. Okay, so now when you will print, what will happen? In fact, the hash code is also different for this. So now, but in the case of std, right now, what is the value of ID? 42. Even if we update the object, the ID will remain what? Same. You can see how now the values are in a red. What does it indicate? You know? It indicates your the last object only has been updated. The object has been updated, but which field has been updated? ID. So it is highlighting your ID has been updated, but it has not changed the object. If you go to the next line, again if you highlight this, you can see that after execution of the next line, it says that what has been updated? Name. It is highlighting, but your object remains same. If the ID is what? 42. So in this way, I summarized, and you people ask me question on the same on mutable and immutable. Okay. In this way, I will say that I would like to finish here. The concept of the mutable and immutable, you can go into the lab and you can practice other things, a lot more things with the mutable and immutable thing. And if you have any doubt, we can always discuss. Okay, that was a very brief overview about the mutable class and immutable class, and with comparison of what?